Test.
Still being surprised that they're trying to get us.
this time, I would like to make a request. If you haven't already silenced your cell phones, please do that. And if you would, please stand to honor the family. You may be seated. Church, hear these words of grace. That dying Christ destroyed our death, and rising Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism Dan put on Christ, so in Christ may Dan be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but what we know, that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. For those who have put on this hope purify themselves, because Christ is pure. Let us be remembered that Jesus said, I am the resurrection, I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. He said, because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we are gathered here today to praise God and to witness our faith as we celebrate the life of Daniel Nutter, who was born January 16th, 1932, in Alcester, South Dakota, died March 21st, 2019, in Marble Falls, Texas, at the age of 87. He is survived by his son, Charles Nutter, of Marble Falls, daughter, Margaret Wolford, of Liberty Hill, granddaughter, Leslie, in Winfield, Kansas, and sister, Rebecca Ashinger, of Omaha, Nebraska, and numerous nieces and nephews. He is preceded in death by his parents, Fayette Alonzo, Lutie Nutter, Elizabeth Jane, his wife Elizabeth Jane Monkern Nutter, and brother Bub Nutter. We come together in grief and acknowledge our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. At this time you may stand to sing the hymn, Old Rugged Cross. Thank you. may be seated for these words of comfort from the book of Psalm, chapter 121. I lift up my heart to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is the shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep you going out and your coming in from this time on and for evermore. Will you join me in our corporate prayer? The words will be on the screen or in your bulletin. O God, who gave us birth, who are forevermore like than we are to pray. You know needs before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Give to us your grace, that we may shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more, solemn message of life and death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, and when our days are accomplished, enable us to die as those who are to live. So when we are dying, our life may be in you, and nothing in life or death will be able to separate us from your great love, Jesus Christ. Let us continue the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Whenever I think of Dan, I think of a spirit of comfort. It's hard for me to think of him without thinking of the smile that he gave me every time I saw him in church. As I read these scriptures, I hope the comfort that he gave me is comfort also received in reading these scriptures. Matthew 25, verses 14 through 23. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. For the one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But to the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid it from his master's money. After a long time, his masters of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, what you handed over to me 5 talents, see, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one who had 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you have handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. Our second lesson comes from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and time for my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which for the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. This is the word of God for the people of God. At this time, we will have some special music.
I want to thank everyone for coming out today as we honor and celebrate the life of Dan Nutter, our father, our grandfather, our father-in-law, uncle, and friend. That pretty well sums it up, as everyone was either family or friend. He never met a stranger. If he didn't know someone, they were simply a friend waiting to be met. We learned at a very early age that everyone mattered. Not by his instruction, but by his example. If anyone needed something, we helped them. If anyone needed to talk, we talked to them. I can remember as a child growing up in Winfield, Kansas, where Dad was library director at Southwestern College for many years, the many lasting bonds that were formed with his Southwestern College kids and Southwestern College faculty, family, it basically is what they were. It was back in the days before the internet and online research, and not uncommon for a student to call on a Saturday morning in a panic, as they had a research paper that was due soon and hadn't finished their research and the library was closed. But what did Dad do? He got up, he put on his clothes, he drove to the library, he let them in, let them do their research, stay as long as they needed to stay there to get everything done. And that way they had their problem taken care of. And you, how many times do you see that? Not too many. It was that type of dedication and compassion that led to so many being so positively impacted by him throughout his long academic career. In later years, he continued to impact many through his dedicated involvement with groups such as the Highland Lakes Master Gardeners, Highland Lakes Master Naturalists, the Birds and Wildflower Society, Burnett County Fair Board, just to name a few. He was literally the Energizer Bunny in everything he did for these groups, and he did everything with his usual determination, along with that infectious award-winning smile. As his health declined over the past few years, his zest for life never did. Even at the very end, that smile never left, nor did his love for life and family and his positive impact on everybody he met, even in the hospital, that remained. I have to think to myself, what a wonderful legacy to leave, to have positively impacted so many people in so many ways. The very fact that he survived his birth 87 years earlier was a miracle in itself, but God had great plans for this man and much work for him to accomplish in those 87 years. We could all learn so much by his example, and we should all be so fortunate to have a life so well lived. Well done, Dad. Rest in peace and fly high until we meet again. Thank you.
Well, friends, I don't know about you, but I'm in awe. A granddaughter who adored her grandfather, the one and only granddaughter, the star of the show, right? Sorry, Leslie. Gets up and plays beautifully. A son and daughter who get up to testify to the love they had for their dad and what impact their dad had on them. I am in awe. I've lost both of my parents, and I personally don't think I didn't have the strength to do that. And so I admire you greatly. Thank you. Friends, won't you pray with me, please? Lord God, hear our prayer. That the word that is spoken and the word that is heard this day may be for us, by the power and inspiration of your Holy Spirit, the word of God, offering comfort and strength this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I have been blessed to be one of Dan Nutter's pastors for almost 8 years, 7.5 to 8 years. Charles and I talked about that a couple of days ago. I always enjoyed visiting with him and seeing that perpetual smile that graced his face. But until last week, I did not know the miracle of his birth. And Charles alluded to that a moment ago, and perhaps you know the story. I did not. So I'm going to share it briefly with you. Daniel was born in South Dakota in the winter, in the middle of January. I can't even envision what the middle of January in South Dakota is like, and I don't want to, okay? That's why I live in Texas. He was delivered by his uncle, who was a doctor. And when he came out, the cord was tied around his neck, having cut off oxygen. They thought he was gone. And so the uncle, the doctor, bundled him and went and set him over on the radiator. Remember those radiator heaters? We even had those in Texas when I was growing up. Because if anything was going to save him, it was going to be that heat. Against all odds, Dan survived. I also did not realize that the cerebral palsy that he lived with throughout his life was a result of that traumatic birth, as was his hearing loss. You know, I just assumed hearing loss came as a malady of older age, not having that length of time with Dan. He always had it. Against all odds, Dan Nutter survived. And it was apparent from that cold January day in 1932 that God had a special plan for his life. I think it's safe to say that his true middle name, while it is Lion, might also be Determination. I mean that as the supreme compliment, because he never gave up. And that's what he taught his children, not to give up, not to let things get you down. Because the Lord knows life can get you down, right, friends? Things happen. Life happens. Despite the many obstacles that he faced over the years, he persevered. He demonstrated to his children and to all who knew him that God has a plan for each one of us. When troubles come, you reach out and you take God's hand and you trust that he will lead you. And I believe that's what Dan did throughout his 87 years. He grew up in that little town, Alcester, until the summer before his senior year in high school, when his dad retired as the postmaster. His mom and dad had visited Texas, Lake Texoma, thought Denison was a pretty neat place, and decided to retire there. Between his junior and senior years, another challenge. Now, I know teenagers today that would just do them in. Don't you? I see some heads bobbing up and down. Not Dan. He was only a Texan for 1 year because he soon, after graduation from Denison High School, enrolled in Southeastern Oklahoma State in Durant. And after graduating with a degree in history, he got his first teaching job in a little East Texas community called Buna. I had to look it up. I got my map out last night. Buna is between Jasper and Beaumont, in case you're wondering. Okay, we're talking deep piney woods. My little map said Big Thicket. It was there that Dan stumbled upon his love for books and the library. When the school librarian had to leave the job for some reason in the middle of the year, Dan was asked to step in and complete the year as the librarian. Isn't it amazing how God's plan catches us by surprise sometimes? He fell in love with the library. During the summers, Dan earned 2 master's degrees in library science over a period of years from the alma mater that we shared, North Texas. At that time, it was called North Texas State College in Denton. Because of what seemed like a very odd turn of events in mid-year, his life took a completely different direction. His first library science job was at a little place called Clarendon, Texas. Anybody know where Clarendon is? In the Panhandle? Okay, a few of you do. Clarendon College, up in the Panhandle. And that was not a coincidence either, because it was there in the first, I think, weeks that he was there, he met the love of his life, Elizabeth Betty Monkern. She was a school music teacher in Clarendon. They were married just a few months later, whirlwind romance, on their Christmas break in December of 63. Dan was determined, and he persevered and went to school most summers. And do you know something else I didn't know about Dan? He was one class and one dissertation short of a PhD. This close to being Dr. Nutter. Margaret came along while they were living in Garland, where Dan was a short stint. He was serving as the librarian at East Texas Baptist College in Marshall. He soon became the librarian at Southwestern College in Winfield, Kansas. And 5 weeks after they moved there, Charles entered the world. The children were blessed to both grow up in that small town and go to Winfield schools, and they have many fond memories. We were talking out here in the hall a minute ago about tornadoes. Not a fond memory, but I'm just amazed at people that live in Kansas. I think it's safe to say that those days, those 18 years in Winfield, were the highlights of Dan's life. He loved that school. After 18 years there, he got a job at Southwestern Oklahoma State University. And 3 years later, the University of Texas at Brownsville was knocking on his door. I've lived in Brownsville. I don't advocate it. But he lived there and served in that school until his retirement in 1999. By then, Margaret was living in Liberty Hill, and it just made sense to be in Central Texas. After visiting several hill country communities, we became the winners, friends, didn't we? They chose Marble Falls to be their forever home. I didn't have the blessing of knowing Betty, but she struggled with several health issues and I think predominantly heart issues and passed to life eternal in December of 2009. But as he proved many times before, Dan persevered through his grief and he did not let it define him. With the encouragement of Margaret and Charles, he began the Master Gardener program and was recently awarded the designation of Master Gardener Emeritus. And I'm so thankful to see all of you here that are Master Gardeners wearing your shirts, and I think some are here that are not wearing their shirts, didn't get the memo, and that's okay. You're here, and that's what matters. I think we have some Master Naturalists here as well, so thank you for your presence and for your love of Dan. As Charles indicated a moment ago, he was a very devoted grandfather. Father, father-in-law, uncle, son. He wore all the hats well. It amazes me how he juggled so many things in his life. But he did it and he did it well. He said he was the best audience for Leslie and for Margaret. He was not musical, in other words. So he enjoyed being the audience. His love of books continued, and I'm told he had an unbelievable collection until the flood last October. Much of his collection was lost, along with many other family treasures that cannot be replaced. So many family photos, other memorabilia. Another challenge, but as my daddy used to say, no hill for a stepper. And Dan was a stepper. Against all odds, here was another obstacle, but Dan kept his mantra of not letting things get you down. From experiencing a heart issue a couple of years ago, to the fall and the broken hip last spring, the flood, the mysterious infection that in recent months plagued his body, and in recent weeks robbed his mobility. But you know what? It did not rob him of his spirit. It did not rob him of his faith and his determination. When I visited with him last Wednesday afternoon, he was tired. He was weak. He opened his mouth and he tried to speak to me, but he just couldn't get the words out. But you could tell he wanted to. He had difficulty keeping his eyes open. I have that effect on people. I looked across the bed. I was on one side of the bed. Charles was on the other. And I said, you know, I don't know why, but God's Spirit's telling me I need to sing something to him. And I had his hand. I had Dan's hand. And I leaned over the bed so he could hear me. And I sang that great song. "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more." I'm a pastor, but I don't get those nudges very often. But boy, when I do, I try to pay attention. Friends, I think I was supposed to sing that song. That is the song that I felt God was telling me to sing. And I think I was supposed to sing that one because that is exactly the way Dan lived his life. Think about it, from day one until last Thursday at 2:30 in the morning, he knew that when life was rocky, he could trust in Jesus. He trusted that Jesus would always be with him no matter what. That miraculous birth in 1932, or that hour when Charles and I were gathered there merely hours from the time that he would take his heavenly journey home. And we didn't know that. We knew it was close. But we also knew God had a plan, and Dan knew that. I believe that for 87 years, Dan viewed his life as one great adventure. He knew that trusting in God would never steer him wrong. On Valentine's Day, something in his condition changed, and he began saying goodbye to Charles and Margaret. I was there, and I could tell there was a significant change in his condition. You see, I think, again, he had that internal thought and that intuition that it was time, and then God was getting ready to take him home. And so right then and there, on the afternoon of Valentine's Day, he started telling them how much he loved them and how proud he was of you. They know that. I want you to hear that. A man could not have two more dedicated children than these two right here. You see, he was living the words of the Apostle Paul that Pastor Clay read a moment ago from 2 Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. I think Dan knew those words, and I think he trusted those words, and I think on Valentine's Day he was being a good dad once again, claiming and witnessing to his faith and preparing his children for that day when our Savior would take him home. He was a powerful witness to all of us that life can be challenging. And how you choose to live into those challenges can define you one way or the other. Dan chose to live his life in such a way as to glorify God in all things and to persevere, trusting that God had his hand against all odds. And that's why I believe that early last Thursday morning, our Lord did take his hand. And he said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of my kingdom." Friends, Dan has been released from his suffering and from the struggles that he lived for 87 years. He was faithful in so many things, and he lived his life as a persevering, joyous witness to God's goodness. So today, even as we grieve, it is with sadness and with joy that we transfer Dan's church membership from the church militant in this place to the church triumphant in the arms of our Lord and of his Christ. And we say thanks be to God for the life of Daniel Lyon Determination Nutter. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Friends, won't you pray with me? Gracious and mighty God, I thank you so much for Dan and for the way that he personally touched my life. Oh God, I want to be like Dan. I want to trust you in the middle of all of things in life. Lord, comfort this family. Strengthen them today. for whatever comes their way. And may we be living witnesses as we glorify and honor you the way Dan did. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Let me invite you at this time to stand as you're able and sing with me those wonderful words, "How Great Thou Art." They'll be on the screen.
Thank you.
the song of Southwestern College, in case you're wondering the significance. The family decided that he needed to have a proper send-off with the song of Southwestern College. So thank you so much. Again, what a testament that they can get up and do that. That amazes people like me. So friends, let me invite you to, well, before I offer the benediction, the brief word of instruction, I'm going to provide the benediction. The funeral directors will then take over and lead us out to the car. I've invited the family to spend just a few moments in the foyer visiting with those of you who are not able to attend to the graveside service. If the pallbearers will join us with the funeral director's guidance as we lead Dan out to the funeral coach, and then the family will remain in the foyer for just a few minutes before we have to depart to go to Lakeland Hills. Okay, now, won't you stand to receive the benediction? Brothers and sisters in Christ, the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. This concludes our service here.